The French. Say what you want about our beret-wearing friends, they certainly know their way around an engineering blueprint and have an impressive industrial legacy that spans numerous industries to back this up. Notably, in aviation, they can boast some groundbreaking firsts, such as being the first to cross the English Channel, when in 1909, Louis Blériot flew from a field in France to Dover in England in 37 minutes. 60 years later, they played a significant role in the development of the sleek, supersonic, and much-loved Concorde. In keeping with the Gallic spirit of firsts and innovations, the French in the 1960s built a revolutionary twin-engine, narrow-bodied passenger aircraft that surpassed the iconic Boeing 737 in speed, outclimbed the McDonnell Douglas DC-9, and accommodated more passengers than both. Equipped with an all-weather automatic landing system, a unique heads-up display, and passenger cabin innovations not seen again until the Boeing 787. You would be forgiven if you've never heard of the Dassault Mercure, because it would go down in aviation history, despite its impressive features and capabilities, as one of the worst commercial failures. This is the incredible story of the infamous Dassault Mercure 100, one of the best passenger aircraft never to succeed. The tale of the Dassault Mercure 100, named after the Roman god Mercury, unfolds in the mid-1960s, when the soared aviation caravel's sales had peaked due to the arrival of more modern competitors. With this, the French Directorate General for Civil Aviation were eager to maintain the country's position in the international airline market that the caravel had achieved. So, the DGAC contacted Marcel Dassault, the founder of Dassault Aviation, and took a long, hard look at the civil aviation market, probably over many leisurely, wine-fueled breakfast meetings.
We leave immediately.
What about dinner?
We leave in 5 hours.
Perhaps during one of these sessions, they believed they had spotted an opportunity in the market that they could fill with a more technically advanced airliner to replace the caravel. What they had noticed were numerous city pairs in Europe and the USA being serviced by dozens of airlines, with many of these routes being under 540 nautical miles, or 1,000 kilometers, routes flown by the likes of the Boeing 737, Douglas DC-9, and BAC-111. Dassault understood these aircraft were not designed or optimized to fly short-haul, therefore, after much cheese and booze had been consumed, they concluded that they were going to take on the American Boeing 737-100, McDonnell Douglas DC-9, and British BAC-111, and be the first to build an airliner explicitly designed to fly these short-haul routes more efficiently than anyone else. Now, this all sounds very promising and exciting. Still, it is essential to keep in mind that up to this point, Dassault had only ever built jet fighters and executive planes, and had never built a commercial jet airliner. So, even though Dassault were newcomers to the market, they were not going to let something as trivial like having zero experience stop them from giving it a go.
C'est une bonne idée, n'est-ce pas?
And what a first go it would turn out to be. Dassault and the DGAC were confident that the short-haul market was ripe for the taking, and with the French government being eager for a homegrown competitor to Boeing and Douglas, they were more than happy to underwrite the project. The government handed over a billion French francs.
Billions?
Equal to 1.138 billion euros today, an investment of 56%, which was to be repaid from the aircraft sales. Dassault threw 14% into the project, with the remaining 30% provided by a consortium of European subcontractors. These subcontractors were responsible for building various parts of the airframe. For example, Fiat of Italy signed on to build the vertical stabilizer and rear fuselage, CASA of Spain the rest of the fuselage, and CABCA of Belgium the aileron and spoilers. Does this remind you of anything? It looks like the start of a pan-European aircraft consortium, much like Airbus. Again, confidence was high, and they estimated airlines would be queuing out the door and around the corner.
Oh, 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 oh.
Dassault predicted that by 1980, 300 of its Mercure 100s would be in service. Therefore, in anticipation of the orders, four factories were built across France to roll out 5 aircraft per month, in Martignan, Poitiers, Chechlin, and with final assembly expected to take place at Istres. I hope you're enjoying this video as much as I enjoyed making it. If you are, please take a moment to hit the like button to feed the YouTube algorithm. A small gesture like that helps the channel grow and reach more people. And perhaps consider subscribing for more aviation content. Now back to the video. From the outset of development in 1967, Dassault focused on designing an airframe that was optimized explicitly for short-haul routes of between 200 and 1500 kilometers. Due to the focus on short-haul, it would need to lift less fuel, which had the immediate advantage that the airframe would have a lower structural weight. Initially, the research team had worked on a 120-seater version, driven by two rear-mounted Rolls-Royce Spey jet engines, much like the DC-9 and BAC-111 layout. But this was changed when it was realized that the Speys would have been inadequate, which resulted in shifting the design specification toward having two wing-mounted Pratt & Whitney JT8D-15 engines, producing about 15,500 pounds of thrust each. These were incidentally the same power plants slung under the wings of the Boeing 737-200. Also, at almost 35 meters, she was longer than the 737, allowing the Mercure to accommodate more seats. For example, Boeing 737-200 variant could manage about 115 passengers, although to be fair to the 737, it could carry up to 136 at a push. However, the Mercure's cabin was also 5 centimeters wider than the 737-200 and could carry up to 155 passengers in a high-density layout. So, 10 points to the French. The wider passenger cabin was laid out in a 6-abreast configuration, with enclosed overhead bins and innovative polarizing windows instead of sliding window shades that the passengers could lighten or darken by rotating a small button at the base of the window, just like on the Boeing 787 Dreamliner of today. However, due to high maintenance costs, the buttons were soon immobilized and the windows left in the lightest position. In June 1969, a full-scale mock-up was presented during the Paris Air Show at Le Bourget Airport. On the 4th of April 1971, the prototype Mercure 1 rolled out of Dassault's Bordeaux-Marignan plant with the Mercure marking, making her maiden flight on the 28th of May 1971. Speed-wise, the Mercure certainly lived up to its name, even though it was larger and a little heavier than the Boeing 737-200. She was the faster of the two, cruising at 575 miles an hour, or almost 1,000 kilometers an hour, with a max speed of Mach 0.85, or 1,041 kilometers an hour, at 20,000 feet, which was impressive when compared to the 737-200. In fact, these speeds are still remarkable to this day, when you consider modern aircraft such as the Airbus A320 cruise at around 560 miles an hour. But Mercure was not only straight-line fast, but she could also out-climb the competition. And at 3,300 feet per second, she was almost twice as fast as its competition, despite being larger. The Mercure even has a better rate of climb than most modern jetliners. During short-haul flights, the Mercure could climb to 35,000 feet, cruise at a fraction under Mach 0.85 or 380 knots, and then descend at such a rate that there are some speed records between French cities set by the Mercure that will never be broken. Pilots, many of whom had a military background, fell in love with the Mercure 100's high G acceleration and ridiculous climb rate, which probably frayed many passengers' nerves. The Mercure's impressive performance was due to how well the airframe was optimized for short-haul routes. By reducing the size of the fuel tanks, as mentioned earlier, Dassault was able to reduce the structural weight of the airframe by 10%, and using extremely modern computer tools for the time, they were able to develop a specialized wing for the Mercure 100, which was 270 square feet greater in area than the 737s, providing it impressive with climb and descent performance, which was handy when climbing out of congested airports on short-haul flights. For example, she was so fast that the Mercure set two speed records, flying the 242 miles from Paris to Lyon in 27 minutes, and the 305 miles from Paris to Bordeaux in just over 30 minutes. Well, we shouldn't be surprised by the Mercure's performance, since she was born out of the Dassault stable, which had decades of experience and expertise in high-speed aerodynamics and low-speed lift capabilities. Expertise gained through the development of jet fighters such as the Ouragan, Mystère, and famous Mirage. The Mercure had a two-crew flight deck fitted with a pioneering all-weather automatic landing system, which made landing in Cat 3A conditions possible. This allowed the Mercure pilots to descend as low as 35 feet, and with a runway visual range of just 125 meters. It gave it a massive advantage over other aircraft considering the terrible winter weather that's common in Northern Europe. The pilots were helped further with the addition of a heads-up display, making it the first airliner to do so. During its 21-year flying career, the Mercure would make 20,704 Cat 3A autolands, almost 1,500 of them in actual low-visibility Cat 3A conditions. So, it seemed that for a first attempt at designing and building a commercial jet airliner, Dassault had hit the bullseye on their first go. She was fast, she carried more passengers, she was efficient and would save airlines money, had all the technology any pilot could want. She was, on paper, for all intents, destined for great success.
Great success.
Well, not really. In fact, quite the opposite. You see, now, this may seem obvious to us today, but apparently the most glaring drawback of this aircraft was its whole reason to exist. Airlines were simply not interested in an aircraft that was only capable of short-haul hops, regardless of how fast she flew, climbed, or how many passengers she could haul. Dassault and the DGAC had completely misread the market and managed to build an aircraft that no one wanted. When you look at a map of France, an aircraft like the Mercure 100 made complete sense, since it could fly from Paris to all the major French cities in one hop. However, problems arose when flying between London and Athens, or Oslo and Marseille in the south of France. Also, keep in mind that Europe is a small continent compared to the US, Canada, and Australia, and airlines around the world want a jet with range. For example, Toronto to Miami is just under 2,000 kilometers, and Sydney to Auckland is just over. These distances are beyond that of even a lightly loaded Mercure 100. The Mercure 100 was so carefully tailored to the needs of short-haul flights that her legs were too short, only able to manage a maximum range of only 2,000 kilometers, and with maximum payload, this was reduced to only 1,000. There was a running joke at the time that the Mercure 100 did not even have the range to leave France. The Boeing 737-200, however, had a range of approximately 4,800 kilometers and could tackle routes between European cities which the Mercure could not, with fuel to spare. Another advantage of the 737 was that its designers had envisioned an airframe able to be adapted to service different markets and cater to both medium and short-haul routes. This adaptability has been proven over multiple generations, across four decades, as the airframe was modified and the range increased from 2,850 kilometers to over 7,000, with nearly double the passenger capacity, which is a testament to the original 737 concept. Even though Mercure had also been designed with the potential to be stretched, its main mission was to be a short-haul airliner, and modifying the airframe to compete with the broad market, which was being served by the 737, was going to be a challenge. Airlines need flexibility, and the Mercure 100 was just not right for them. Even Air France, who were looking for a replacement to the unique Caravelle, said non to the homegrown Mercure and instead opted for the Boeing 727. Sabena, the Belgian flag carrier, was said to be sniffing about the Mercure, but in the end, they too walked away into the arms of the Americans. In the end, the internal French carrier, Air Inter, a semi-public French domestic airline in which the French government had partial ownership, was the only airline to order the Mercure 100. It was through the complete series of agreements between the French government, Dassault, and the airline that they ended up with a fleet of just 10 aircraft. However, an 11th Mercure, a refurbished prototype, was later added to the Air Inter fleet. To add insult to injury, as Dassault were looking for customers for their newest jet, the 1973 oil crisis hit, which drove up operating costs, and the devaluation of the dollar made the export price of the Mercure even more unattractive to potential US customers. A higher rate of inflation in Europe, along with the lack of global product support infrastructure that Boeing and Douglas offered, and a total lack of track record, nailed the door shut for any success the Mercure could have had in the overseas market. Not to be put off by the commercial failure of the Mercure 100, Dassault, in cooperation with Air France, put forward a new version of the Mercure to be named the Mercure 200C, to carry a maximum of 150 passengers over 2,200 kilometers in two classes. This concept did gain some interest from American carriers. However, the project stalled when Air France demanded that the aircraft be powered with the Pratt & Whitney JT8D-117, requiring an additional 80 million French francs loan, or slightly over 113 million in today's money. Also, the modifications needed to engineer the airframe to accommodate larger fuel tanks were just too expensive for the aeroplane ever to make a profit. The French government was not too keen on coughing up more cash, and insisted that Dassault should stump up half of the Mercure 200C development costs, which, still licking its wounds after this Mercure 100 failure, was impossible for the company to do so, and this finally led to the project being cancelled. However, Dassault was not ready to give up easily. In 1975, they approached Lockheed and Douglas to build a Mercure 200 under license with CFM International, CFM 56 power plants, named the Mercure 200. They dropped the C for this version, but the negotiations did not amount to anything. Over the years, there was criticism for attempting to compete with the 737 and DC-9 when the Mercure should have been marketed as a high-capacity regional airliner. However, the Mercure did achieve some impressive numbers, which are worth noting. For instance, the Mercure had a perfect safety record during its 21-year flying career, with the final flight on the 29th of April 1995. During this time, the Mercures flew 360,000 hours, carrying 44 million passengers on 440,000 flights, with 21,000 Cat 3A autolands, 1,400 of them in actual low-visibility Cat 3A conditions. Although the Mercure 100 was a commercial failure, the project laid the groundwork for the success of Airbus, by demonstrating the need to create an airframe that is flexible enough to service a wide range of different carrier requirements. An expensive lesson, perhaps, but the versatility of the A320 is one of the greatest attributes and didn't come out of nowhere. So, maybe the Mercure was a success, after all.